Building up some ice on my wing.
Okay, let's get it down to where it's warmer to melt it off. Ask to descend to a lower altitude, 14,000.
Roger.
Then.
Feel that?
The situation suddenly changes.
Propeller's vibrating.
The pilots feel some vibrations. It could be a sign of ice building up on the propellers.
Oh, hell. Come on, I've got an idea.
With little data from the FDR, NTSB investigator John McAdill comes up with an unusual way to analyze the power coming from Flight 90's engines by analyzing the sound they made. Jet engines contain turbines that make different sounds depending on how quickly they're spinning. When the engine needs more power, the turbine spins faster and the frequency of the sound changes.
You ready to go?
Yeah.
The sound of Flight 90's engines should tell McAdill how much power they were generating. And thanks to the unique design of the 737, with its engines mounted close to the cockpit, he already has a recording of the sound he needs. They play back the cockpit voice recorder in a soundproof room.
120.
V1.
Easy.
Can you take the stick shaker out? Lose the crew voices.
Forward, forward.
The technician eliminates the other sounds in the cockpit one by one until all that's left is the sound of the engines. The results are dramatic. Investigators now know that the Boeing 737's engines weren't running at full power during takeoff. What they don't know is why. McAdill has no hard evidence that the sensor was blocked, but he decides to follow a hunch. He uses a piece of tape to simulate the effect of ice blocking the engine sensor. He recreates the actions of the pilots on the day of the flight.
Okay, start her up.
And he records the sound of the engines from inside the cockpit.
Keep throttling up.
He increases power until the engine gauges match the target set by the crew of Flight 90.
Got it.
Blocking the sensors on the test flight should create the same reduction in engine performance as on Flight 90. Both engines should sound identical.
Okay, let's see what we've got.
McAdill compares the sound of his test flight to the engine noise captured during Flight 90's takeoff.
That's a perfect match.
Investigators believe the ice in the wings degraded the plane's performance. When combined with low engine power, though, it was enough to rob the pilots of the lift they needed to climb. The Air Florida disaster was a wake-up call for better flight safety in winter conditions. In the aftermath of this accident, northern airports around the world improved de-icing facilities so that pilots can de-ice near the runway just before takeoff. Powerful technology now clears runways faster, helping airports avoid long delays after a heavy snowfall. Since the Air Florida disaster, pilots and regulators better understand the risk of winter flight. The Canadian Arctic is one of the toughest environments on the planet. Winters here are brutal, 8 months long, with temperatures plunging to minus 40 degrees Fahrenheit. Even now, during the long days of the Arctic summer, the average temperature is barely above freezing. There are no roads to this part of the world. Virtually the only way to get here is by air. Resolute Bay Airport is the only one in the region equipped with navigational aids for automated landing approaches. First Air Flight 6560 is a charter flying passengers and cargo to the small community.
Wind 180 degrees at 8 knots.
First Officer David Hare studied business before setting his sights on aviation. He joined First Air 4 years ago.
First Air 6560, copy. Thank you. There we go.
Captain Blair Rutherford has been with the airline for more than 15 years.
Might as well do yours, too. Heading 029 degrees. Got it.
This close to the magnetic North Pole, pilots need to calibrate their compasses frequently using their GPS.
Okay, let's go over the approach. Okay. Altitude alert set to 2200.
Because of the heavy fog, the crew will be relying on their autopilot during the approach.
Checklist complete. Autopilot. Set.
This way, they don't have to worry about lining up with a runway visually. The computer will do all the work until they're ready to touch down.
You're landing on runway 35 true. It's a little wet.
First Air 6560, copy. 35 true.
We're 10 miles from runway.
At 11:40 a.m., Flight 6560 begins its final approach to the runway.
Descending through 1,000 feet. First Air 6560, we're 3 miles out on final. We're over the shoreline now. All right.
The sound of an urgent alarm fills the cockpit.
Go around, go for it.
It's the low altitude warning. To the pilots, it seems impossible. They don't even have the runway in sight yet.
Go around thrust.
The captain decides to abort the landing, but it may be too late. Flight 6560 slams into the ground at 180 miles an hour. The plane skids across the crest of a hill and bursts into flames. The cause of the crash remains a mystery. 18 days into the investigation, the Canadian government appoints Justice Virgil Moshansky to lead a more wide-ranging inquiry into all aspects of the aviation system that might have contributed to the Air Ontario tragedy.
The government was looking for an experienced trial judge and preferably one who had an aviation background.
Moshansky is an experienced pilot with 13 years on the bench. He will work closely with crash investigator David Rohrer and aviation consultant Frank Black. The new team's first step, assessing the plane's technical systems.
The electrical system, the hydraulic system, the fuel system, all of these systems are looked at both in terms of what is their history leading up to the accident and what remnants are remaining at the crash site that can be examined.
Clues to a possible system failure arise when Sonia Hartwick recalls a troubling event.
As we took off, I noticed that the wings just became a solid sheen of gray, shiny ice.
Investigators consult the F-28's manuals to study its de-icing systems. They find that only the wings' leading edges are protected.
The aircraft had heated leading edges on the wings.
I wonder if the anti-icing system was working.
And the heat was provided by bleed air from the compressors on the engine. They found the valves that allow the compressed air access to the leading edges. And they tested the valve to see if it functioned, and it did.
The anti-icing system was working. But since it only heats the leading edge, it likely didn't clear ice that formed on the surface of Flight 1363's wings. Investigators suspect that snow and ice buildup, what experts call wing contamination, may have played a major role in the crash. To verify that suspicion, Rohrer and his team meet with engineers from FAA.
Thanks for coming. Curious to see what you have.
Jack Van Hengst, who was the chief engineer, had extensive aerodynamic studies and data on the effects of contamination on an F-28 airplane.
Fokker engineers have run simulations of the crash.
They were able to get some very good data in terms of the performance of the airplane, simulating the type of loads, temperatures, etc., that the Dryden aircraft would have been exposed to.
Investigators make a crucial discovery about the design of the F-28. Because of the angle of the wings, a very small amount of ice makes the plane susceptible to stalling.
They concluded that even the most minute bit of contamination on the wing would disrupt the airflow and cause a loss of lift.
Well, that answers a lot of questions.
The simulations support what witnesses saw.
It just barely got airborne, dropping wings, losing lift, and then hitting trees, decelerating to the point where it broke up.
Investigators are now certain that contaminated wings caused the crash. But what's still unclear is why the plane was not de-iced before takeoff. May 18th, 2011.
Seoul Flight 5428, you are clear for takeoff.
Roger, Seoul Flight 5428, clear for takeoff. V1, rotate.
At 8.05 p.m., Seoul Flight 5428 lifts off from the airport in Naoki.
Positive rate.
The plane will fly directly south from Neuquén to Comodoro Rivadavia on the Patagonian coast. As per their flight plan, the Saab 340 will climb to a cruising altitude of 19,000 feet.
Looks like we're picking up some ice.
Nothing to worry about. We're expecting some light icing. Should be better when we get to 19,000.
At 19,000 feet, water droplets freeze solid, which keeps them from clinging to the aircraft.
Building up some ice on my wing.
Okay, let's get it down to where it's warmer to melt it off. Ask to descend to a lower altitude, 14,000.
Roger.
Then,
feel that?
The situation suddenly changes.
Propeller's vibrating.
The pilots feel some vibrations. It could be a sign of ice building up on the propellers.
Put them on max.
Roger.
Oh, hell.
What's wrong?
I don't know.
The turboprop is suddenly pitching down and banking.
Pull back, Carter.
We're trying.
The pilots struggle to get the plane under control.
Come on. Come on.
The turboprop crashes and explodes in a remote region of Patagonia. Argentina's civil defense agency sends emergency crews to the crash site.
But because of its remote location on a desert plateau in Rio Negro province, it takes hours for them to arrive. When the crews do arrive, they find there are no survivors.